So this is unplugged. I am not prepared, she is not prepared. Okay. Yes. When she came, she said, "Feroz, I am not the crying kind."
Okay. You're not supposed to embarrass me.
So, this is my, you were supposed to be here. I've been chasing her for the last 5 years now. I'll tell you my part of the story and then Nandita will tell hers. So it's like one religious male will start in November because I have to plan 1 year in advance and I'll say, "Now, Nandita, are you coming?" And of course, she's very sweet and say, "I have a busy schedule. I'll do my best. I want to support you." But that's gone on for 5 years now and finally she is here. So let's hear it for Nandita Das.
Thank you. Thank you, in fact, Feroz. Thank you for so gently sort of being after me to come, but always gently. And I'm so glad I came. I think this is such a moving experience and I think I'm going to take back more than you are going to.
Thank you. She's been very generous. As I said, last 2 years, she was 3 years actually, she was so busy with Manto that she had no time at all. But I met her in California 2 months back and kind of put the seed in her that she has to come again. And she said, "No, I'm not coming this year because I'm very busy." And then I chased her again and then she said, "Maybe I have a bigger time window this year than next year because next year she'll be again shooting for a film." And she said, "Okay, I'm going to come and support you." The interesting thing is she said, "Subah 9:30 ko kaun aayega yaar meri baatein sunne?" And then she came into the room, she's like, "Is this real? There's so many people, right? So tell me, this is my part of the story. Tell me, what did you think when you walked in today?"
I have to admit that, you know, over the years, you become a bit cynical about conferences and summits and you think, okay, I'm just going to go for my session, do my little bit to talk about things. Many have inspired me and I hope I can do the same for a few more. There'll be some big bhashan, some speeches and it'll carry on. When I entered, the whole spirit, the whole energy was so different. He first took me to the room full of beautiful art that I couldn't see because I was blindfolded. And I was feeling and touching and then the voices came and it was just, I mean, already I felt like I was experiencing. This is not a place where we only talk or hear, but I think we feel each other. And more than anything else, we feel together. I think today is the time where we have to start connecting the dots and feeling less isolated. All of us feel isolated in different circumstances. We feel nobody understands us. We feel that our struggles are unique. But when you come to a place like this, I think we feel the togetherness so much more. And thank you, Feroz, therefore, for calling me.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So, you know, talking about Nandita is incredibly hard because she's done so many different things. I say it's like a perfect example of a polyglot, right? Who's multiple talents, good at almost everything she does. She's done more than 40 different films in 10 languages. Now, I have no clue that how she manages 10 languages. She's done one in Kannada also, by the way. That's what I heard. I haven't seen it, but so 40 movies in 10 different languages. She's directed 2 movies on a span of almost 10 years, right? Direction takes a lot out of you. So 2 outstanding movies, both has won numerous awards. She's been the chairperson in the Children's Film Festival for a few years, Film Society. She wrote a column for almost 8 years, right? For The Week, 9 years for A Week, and so on and so forth. So my question is, I know these are different things and requires different levels of skill. What is your personal favorite and how do you manage to do so many different things? I'm not even talking about your lovely kid and the other, you know, which is probably the more harder part of your life. But tell me, how do you manage so many different roles? And which is the one that is most close to you? Is it acting, directing, writing, you know, the social work? I don't even know whether she's a social activist or whatever you call that.
I know all big names and labels.
Yeah.
I think many of us multitask. I'm sure women tend to multitask more. I'm not out of choice, but out of compulsion. And I would say that I don't take that as a compliment anymore because I also want to focus like most men do. You know, they are more compartmentalized when you're working, when you're being a
Every
father.
Every time I'm with Nandita, meri leti hai, matlab. Le lo.
But I'm sure there's so many women here. We all do so many different things and there's so much that we carry in our heads. It's not only about doing the worrying and, you know, thinking about various things. You want to constantly optimize. For me, I don't think I've really had a career. Like, you know, I think specialization is slightly overrated, that you have to do one thing and you have to excel in it. But what if you have many interests? What if you want to do many different things? If you have a particular goal, if that's what you want to do, great. There's nothing wrong with having a calling either. But if your interests are many, and I think the work that I've done comes from a deeper reason of just wanting to share, wanting to express, wanting to find different creative ways to do that. So whether I'm writing a column, whether I'm coming and sitting here and talking with you, whether I'm doing a film, whether I'm acting in a film, all of these for me come from the same intent. These are all just means to an end. So for me, there is really no favorite. If I'm sitting here and talking to you, I'm only at the moment thinking about that, and this takes precedence over everything else. If I'm directing, then that becomes the most important thing. So I think it keeps shifting, but it comes from a deeper anguish of how we have divided ourselves, how there is a sense of them and us in every way. I mean, many of you know it firsthand, but we divide ourselves in the name of religion, in the name of caste, in the name of how we look, the color of our skin, you know, whether we speak English or we don't, which region do we belong to, what sexual preference we may have, gender. We have just found so many ways to divide us. And I think that's something that deeply troubles me. And if there's something that I can do in my own little way and creatively share it with others, that is what I think motivates me and propels me.
Now, give a round of applause for her.
You don't have to clap.
No, the thing that you kept the idea of diversity and inclusion at the core of a lot of the work. And one of the things I remember was the campaign called India's Got Color. And I just saw a newer version of it. I think it was done 2013. There was...
So I'll just tell you a little bit about that. So as especially those who are darker skin color, and which means almost more than 80% of India's population, we know that there is a fair amount of obsession with lighter skin, and constantly we are told that we are not good enough. You know, in whichever work we may do, we will not find a partner, we will not get work, we are somewhere our self-worth is questioned just because of the color of our skin. I was very fortunate that my parents didn't put this complex in my head, but growing up years, you cannot escape this prejudice. So in 2013, there's an organization called Women of Worth, they're Chennai based. They contacted me and said that we have a campaign called Dark is Beautiful and will you support it? And I didn't think it required a standalone attention because there are so many issues that women deal with, starting even before they are born. As we know, there is female feticide, female infanticide, lack of opportunities for girls to study for nutrition. Then, you know, no, they can't decide whom they want to get married. Once they're married, there's domestic violence, there are dowry debts, there are widow issues. So it's like from literally cradle to grave, there are so many issues. So I thought, does this really require as a standalone focus? And I was very wrong, because once I started supporting in 2013, I became the face of the campaign by default, because many actors were increasingly sort of getting lighter and lighter with every film, and no names to be given. But, and then it started, you know, getting a lot of attention. A lot of young women would come up to me and say, thank you for doing this campaign, I feel a little better about myself. 2019, this year, it's their 10th anniversary, and they asked me if I could do something for it. I have always been very uncomfortable with this idea of dark is beautiful. You know, it sort of reinforces this whole thing of dark and beautiful. Why should we women be so burdened by beauty anyway? I mean, there's much more to us than just being beautiful. And how do you define beauty? And, you know, we have standardized even the definition of beauty. So that's when I said, okay, why don't we call it India's Got Color? And while the skin color is the entry, it is to basically celebrate diversity of all kinds, 1.3 billion people and that many colors of skin tone and that many people. And I think you know it more than anybody else does.
Fantastic. So we'll watch the India's Got Color video, okay? Show the full one, don't abridge it.
India mein jitne log, utne rang. Magar phir bhi hum nahi sudhrenge. Haan?
देखा है तुम्हें ताने मारते हुए धुतकारते हुए तुम्हें हाँ रंग का मजाक उड़ाते हुए तुम्हें हाँ देखा है तुम्हें ताने मारते हुए धुतकारते हुए तुम्हें हाँ रंग का मजाक उड़ाते हुए उड़ाते
के लिए काली गोरी लड़की चलेगी, पर शादी करना है तो गोरी लड़की से ही करेगा। बेटा तो सुन तेरे अच्छे के लिए बोलो, नहीं तो तेरा बच्चा बड़ा होके तुझे गाली देगा। औरत अगर होगी गोरी तेरी सोसाइटी में भी तेरा भाव बढ़ जाएगा।
देख बहुरानी गौर से सुन, मुझे गोरा बच्चा चाहिए कान खोल के सुन। बेटा चाय ना पी बच्चा काला हो जाएगा, इस दुनिया की भीड़ में अनजाना हो जाएगा। धूप में न जा रंग मैला हो जाएगा, दादी की मेहनत का ठेंगा हो जाएगा।
देखा है तुम्हें ताने मारते हुए, धुतकारते हुए तुम्हें, हाँ रंग का मजाक उड़ाते हुए, उड़ाते हुए तुम्हें, हाँ।
अरे यार देखो कौन यहाँ आ गया, सावला है रंग जिसका अंधेरा बचा गया। लाइट मुझे अब बढ़ाना पड़ेगा, मेकअप मैन को बोल के इसको गोरा करना पड़ेगा। फोटोशॉप में भी मेहनत करना पड़ेगा, तभी इसका फोटो मैगजीन में छपेगा।
जज ने भी बोला तेरे अंडर टैलेंट बहुत है, पर तेरे जैसों को हम देते नहीं स्लॉट है। कला जो भी हो तेरा रंग तेरा लॉस है, जो यहाँ पे गोरा वही जाएगा टॉप पे। तेरे बस का नहीं कहीं और तू ध्यान दे, टैलेंट शो छोड़ के लग जा तू किसी काम पे।
पर अब टाइम आ गया है रंग मंग को छोड़ने का,
नीचा किसी को ना दिखाने का,
कोई और करे तो उसको भी बोलने का,
हर रंग को सेलिब्रेट करने का,
क्योंकि
इंडिया'स गॉट कलर।
So that was the latest one. This was released a month back, if I remember, right?
September. It's September 25th.
It's a beautiful piece. You go to YouTube, find it out. It's amazing. I want to spend a little time on talking about Manto. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie, how many of you know about Manto. But, you know, I want you to explain why did you choose a topic like Manto? And you speak about Manto Niyat. What is that? And I'm trying to kind of a loaded question now here. If Manto was here in the summit today, what would his message have been for inclusion?
So Manto, for those of you who may not know, Manto, the full name is Sadat Hasan Manto. He was a short story writer of the 40s. He grew up in Amritsar, did about 100 radio plays in Delhi, went to Bombay, also wrote film scripts. But mainly he's known for his stories and essays that talk about the society unapologetically, without any frills. He was very, very brutally honest about how he saw the world. And he saw it with all his own. I mean, he always said that, you know, if you're a human being, you ought to be progressive. And Manto is a human being. So it's not even a choice. And therefore, he would talk about various aspects of people, especially those on the margins of society, people like sex workers and, you know, people. He wasn't, in fact, interested. He would say, I'm not really interested in the regular women, you know, who are housewives who take beatings from their husbands and then go and polish their shoes. So he was quite sort of ruthless in the way he looked at things. You could put any religion in any of his characters. You could swap the religion and it wouldn't matter. He basically felt that we are, like I said in the beginning, that, you know, even though India and Pakistan have been free, have been independent, we are still a slave to our prejudices, to our barbarism. That was his point of view. For me, he symbolizes free spirit, courage, and honesty. And that's what I mean when I say that through the film, it was not only to bring in more awareness about who Manto was, but to spread Manto Yat. And when I say Manto Yat, it means that will to be more honest, that will to be more courageous, that will to be more free-spirited, that I believe all of us have, but we really don't come out in those ways because we are scared of what people will say, we are scared of how the world will look at us, and we stop ourselves from that. And I think today, if he was here in the summit, he would just be sitting somewhere as one of us. And like as Joe Chopra said, you know, there's no need to kind of keep shouting and demanding. We are here, each one of us, and we are going to make a place for ourselves.
Fantastic. Lovely. What a beautiful message. I must confess I'm a Nandita Das fan, so I can keep here and keep chatting and bore you guys to death. Not from my talk, but I want you to give you guys a chance to ask questions. So if you have a question, raise your hand, keep it short, tell your name, ask the question, and a mic runner will come to you. Is that okay? Okay. Let's ask, raise your hands. Normally I have front.
Hi, friends.
Okay. Ashwin is there. Ashwin.
Yeah. I'm a huge fan of yours, and I think that you're one of the most honest actors in India. And my question to you is, you have done so many diverse roles and films and writing and all of it. So, in your opinion, food and we've also had so many good movies about people with disabilities. But in your opinion, would you want to do a role or direct a movie which is related to disability?
Yeah. Just to repeat the question, please correct me if I'm wrong. He asked that there are so few films on disability, and would I like to do a film on the subject? Is that the question?
And that's our rock star, Ashwin. This is the only place where you get claps for even asking questions, because the guys who are asking questions are such outstanding individuals.
Yes.
Ashwin, for Nandita's information, was a president's medalist for being a role model employee. Got an award from Pranab Mukherjee. I keep joking that he's got all the awards except Filmfare Award. So that also he will get. That's why I know your question. Buddy, one, I know you.
Yes. He wants to act in that film. Ah, I got
Filmfare
it.
You want. Okay.
No, I want to
don't cover up. I know. I know.
And
don't justify. You will meet Nandita later.
Okay. I will.
So Ashwin is my dear friend. So we keep pulling each other's legs. I've written about him. So I can get away by being nasty to him.
You have the rights.
Yeah. Okay. Nandita, yeah.
So, yes, it's true that there are very few films that are about disability, and that too shown sensitively and in the way the realities are. But, mainstream cinema largely has to obviously please a lot more people. That's why we call it mainstream, because it has to appeal to a lot of people. So often, things that need a lot more nuances, things that are more to the margins in terms of the themes and subjects, are often not taken. Having said that, there have been some films. The one that comes to mind is Margarita with a Straw. I think that did deal with it, and I'm sure. But it doesn't even need to be centric towards a particular subject. Even if there are characters that are just part of that world, as we all are. But in a country like ours, in a world like ours, there is no dearth of, unfortunately, causes and issues and people who are being pushed to the margins constantly. We are largely a fairly insensitive society. I'm sorry to say that, but we have to face it every time. I remember many years ago, after my master's in social work, when I was working with an NGO, in fact, I was part of the core group that started a film festival on disability in Delhi. And we kind of tried to sustain it. I don't know where it is now, because I'm in Bombay now and I haven't been following in the last few years. But that's when we started, and we were really struggling, because I used to select some of the films for the festival. That there were films, but good films. Like, how do we have stories that are genuine? And when I say good, not just in terms of how they are made, but how it is portrayed correctly. Because oftentimes the intention is good, but sometimes it's like trying to pity or trying to not show it in the right light. We wouldn't call them good films. So definitely there's a greater need. In fact, just before we were coming up, I was telling Ferose that in my next film, you have to help me get a lot of people. It doesn't only have to be in front of the camera. We also need far more representation behind the camera. Because I was seeing all the names and the work that a lot of you are doing, and unfortunately, we don't get to know. Even women who hold up half the sky, we are 50% of the population. And if you actually see the percentage of women who are behind the camera, is very, very small. In every profession, actually, maybe other than teachers and nurses, the caregiver roles, women are largely very few. So, whether it is inclusion of gays, whether it's inclusion of disability, whether it's inclusion of Dalits, whether it's inclusion of Muslims, in so many categories we are struggling with, because the dominant community, whatever that may be, often tends to decide and, take up all the space. So we all have to push it. And I promise you, I'm also complicit in this, so I promise you that I'm going to do my best to be far more inclusive than I've been.
I want to challenge you there, Nandita, on one insight, especially from the West, and this is blew my mind off when I looked at that numbers. In the last 27 years in the history of Hollywood, 17 people who got the best actor or actress award for Oscar award got it for a role of playing a person with disability. 17 out of 27 best actor or actress award went to a person where the protagonist was a person with disability. It started right from Rain Man to so many other outstanding individuals. So there is a space for people with disability, but the important thing is how they have carried it with such sensitivity that they get an Oscar award for performing that role, whether it's doing the role of Stephen Hawkins and so many other outstanding people. So I think there is a need to change that narrative in an India context. I mean, we had Nagesh here 2 years back. He spoke about Iqbal, which I think is a beautifully done movie. I think we need more of those to bring the idea of disability and inclusion to the mainstream. I have got questions from the live audience as well. If there is any question from the audience here, yes, Siddharth, you, when one chance you get, you stand up. Okay, what to do? Ask. He's also my friend, so I can pull my leg with him. He's on the one of the board members in our foundation. Yes, Siddharth.
And he's always jealous that I talk too much.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Suppose I am to say, of course, I admit, you are very beautiful, okay? But my question to you, how do you define beauty?
How do you define beauty?
Yeah, how do you define beauty?
Macha, we have only 5 minutes to answer that.
No, it's a beautiful question. So, I mean, it is a difficult one, and it sounds like a cliche, but really beauty lies in the eyes of the beholder. You know, the one who is seeing what is beautiful for you may not be beautiful for me or somebody else. And especially like we were talking about this campaign, for instance, you know, a lot of the times people say that is beauty inside? It is also physical, it is also inside, it is in the smell, it's in the touch. There's so many things. When you say beautiful experience, you say a beautiful moment, beauty is not just physical. Beauty, obviously, why do we attach it to so many different things? Is it vibration? What is it? So by defining it, I think we'll be narrowing it. We'll be putting it in a box, and it will take away from the fact that beauty is really in the eyes of the beholder, and it's in that moment. So I would say anything that makes you feel good, anything that fills you with some happiness, it's beautiful. And this moment is beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Siddharth, for that beautiful question. Yes, I have, boy, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, okay. Yeah.
Both your films have been on real life instances, be it partition or 2002 riots. My question to you as a creative person or director for that role, what is more difficult? Is it putting your storyline based on the real life incidents or creating something out of nowhere, total fiction? So as a creative person, what is difficult and what's your next film all about?
So yeah, the first film I did was called Firaq. It was in 2008. And while it was based on reality, as in what had happened in Gujarat in 2002, it sort of deeply bothered me because that was the first time we were actually seeing visuals of what was happening. Before that, there was no this 24-hour news. We had only heard about the violence of partition. We had seen some footage, you know, or of the Sikh riots. But we hadn't really seen it up close, personal. And also, I was in the field. I was about 10 years maybe old in the field, and I thought there's something that I can do to tell this story. But the first line in Firaq is, this is a work of fiction based on 1,000 true stories. So it was not that I had taken a character and I had put it in the film. It was part of many of my life experiences, not only from Gujarat. Like Nasiruddin Shah's character was based on many older people that, you know, whether it was Mrinal Sen, whether it was Kuldeep Nair, many old people that I was close to, and their optimism and their will to change much more than sometimes young people who tend to get more cynical. So Manto was much closer to reality, but even there, I had no clue how he spoke to his wife. What did they talk in their bedroom? How did he feel when Gandhi died? And you know, what was the reaction? So there were fictional elements, but I did about 4 or 5 years of research because I was dealing with a reality, and his daughters and his family that I'm very close to, I almost felt I owe it to them to, you know, represent their parents correctly. So I think whether it's fiction or not, it doesn't matter, because even fiction is rooted in reality. You fictionalize something that you have felt, that you have seen, that you have experienced. So for me, the line in that sense is fairly blurred. I want to tell stories that deeply impact me, that are sort of dying to come out. Both Firak and Manto were not born because I wanted to be a director, but because I wanted to tell these stories. And so, like I said, you know, it is, for me, films is a means to an end, and sort of not an end in itself so much. And because prejudice and how religion has started playing this crazy role in our society, where it's dividing us further, in a country that was meant to be secular and equal, which still is in our constitution. And you know, I was just deeply troubled by prejudice. And you can then expand it to anything, whether it's disability, whether it's gender, whether it's caste, as long as you can see that this trouble of them and us is being created, and how do we deal with it? How do our characters deal with it? I think you can extrapolate. My next project is, there are a couple of things that I'm toying with. It's too early to say. I've just finished a book on the journey of making Manto. So I don't know, I think my Manto journey has just gone on too long. But I needed this catharsis of just sharing what happened behind the scenes. And it'll come out later this year, and I hope some of you can see it.
Absolutely. Thank you. Look forward to reading that, Nandita. So this question is from the live audience, which says, how can common people like us and the celebrities come together to make a change in India? Because a lot of the videos sometimes you see are all of celebrities. So the question was more, I think, common people like all of us here and celebrities come together to drive a change.
No, if you see the video, actually, it's very mixed. I mean, we are a bit of a celebrity-driven country, media. I mean, you think about your own self. What do you read when you see a photograph and, you know, you see a big actor selling something that you're 100% sure he's not even using it. I don't want to name them. But, you know, they keep selling them again and again, and somebody must be buying it for them to be hired for the job. So in this video also, the India's Got Colour, if you see, it's very mixed. In fact, the non-actors and the actors, they keep sort of rotating, and you're sort of, you don't know which one of them. Because you recognize the celebrity, you see them more. And, you know, when we start looking, we start creating heroes. Everyday heroes, there are so many wonderful people, and you know so many of them who are doing amazing work. We have to create them as well. I think when we start not dividing as common people and celebrities, that's when the change will happen. And also, celebrities are human beings. I mean, if I come here, I'm not coming, maybe I will give one or two interviews, and if it helps the cause, great. But I'm coming here as a person. I'm coming here as someone who cares about what you all are talking about. I'm coming here in solidarity with Feroz, my friend, and a committed sort of soldier. And, you know, to share, we are sharing a certain vibration, even though it's sort of one-sided talk, unfortunately, right now. But we are together, and I think that is going to create change. Change is often not visible, and therefore disheartening. It overwhelms us that it's so enormous, and what can we really do? But each of us has an area of influence. So each of us can influence our surrounding and our own selves. So there's no time to lose hope, and you know, we just have to carry on, and change will happen.
Thank you. Beautiful. Thank you. Okay, I saw a lot of hands. I don't know which side I will go to. You know, this is Nandita, you choose. Okay. Anu.
Hi,
she was the artist.
I'm a great painting. Fan of you.
Now I am too.
No, ma'am, you are the big. And ma'am, at the end, I want to have a photo with you. Yes. And ma'am, I want to ask you one question. You're going to work on a movie for disabled. So I just want to ask you, what does it mean for you? What is disabled? And how will you differentiate between other people and disabled?
OK. Okay. Firstly, I haven't yet committed that I'm going to do my next film on disability.
You were planning.
But I'm going to be definitely more conscious because there's so many issues, like I mentioned.
Yeah.
But this is a very, very important one. How do you define? If you see, even the words have changed, right? We do not, in fact, why do we not call it disabled? Why do we call it differently abled? Why do we say special child? These are not just words.
Exactly.
You can use it just as words and it can become a tokenism.
So in that movie, can you say, give a message that this word should be go out of the world? These words?
Yeah, but you know, I also know
people. Because it pinches a lot of people who are doing a lot of work.
Absolutely.
Instead of having a lot of problem in their life. Why to give this word to them?
You're absolutely right. You know, we label people, not just in this, we label people for everything.
Exactly. We should stop.
Why do we label? Because we don't really care. We don't give time to each other. So if you will think of me, oh, like celebrity or an actor, director, you know, somebody we say, oh, so-and-so is blind, or somebody's gay, or somebody's Muslim, somebody's Dalit, somebody's a woman, whatever, we label because we largely do not give that time. The minute we get to know each other a little more, I want to believe that all of us are actually sensitive humanist people. And the minute we get to know more, we understand. I know people who use the word not so politically correctly, but actually more sensitive also.
Exactly.
I know people who use the word correctly, special people, differently able, and may not be sensitive.
Yep.
So I think intention is very powerful.
Yeah.
What is the intention behind how we look at each other, how we see each other, how we want to be closer to each other? So that should be the spirit. And we are all differently able in everything.
Yeah,
you know, so
exactly.
I mean, I am differently able in something, he is, we are, but we do not. This is just the unfortunate situation,
yeah.
And we have to change it.
Yeah.
There is no they.
Exactly.
The society is made up of all of us.
Exactly.
When we change it, like I said, if there were more people with different abilities included in films, mm-hmm. people will get to know. And every time you do that, you open doors for more and more people. Ask people who are older here, they would tell you that 20 years ago, was there as much understanding of it?
No.
Are there more ramps today than there were 20 years ago? Of course there are more. So things are changing. We can only hasten it. Because there is an urgent need. Sometimes we don't realize the urgency. Because while we create the change, the slow change, so many lives are getting destroyed.
Yeah.
So all of us are here, not just to change, but to hasten that change.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anu, for doing such beautiful painting and raising such questions.
Thank you. We'll take one last question. We're running out of time. I'll take on the gentleman on the right side. Yeah.
Very nice talk. You promised that you are more than willing to work for the inclusion of people with disabilities. So can you begin by doing one small change? So you made a very nice film. What if it had captions and subtitles were not there?
Subtitles are there. I think they got probably, because there are many people have taken that video on various YouTube channels. It's open source. I have not claimed, you know, I've produced it and directed it along with another filmmaker called Mahesh Mathai. But we have just given it out. So there is a YouTube one which has subtitles. The Tamil one is happening as we speak. I encourage people to use it in different languages, and also the video that you have created, I will make sure that I spread it in my social media and ask others to do it. So we all have to help each other, and you know, just to create.
Thank you.
We have to create a more compassionate society, and it's going to take time, but let's all do it together.
Sure.
On that note, I know somebody's like jumping. No. One question. Okay, one last question there. Sunil, don't kill me for that, but. Yeah.
Yes, please.
Microphone is not working. Sorry about that. Sorry, this
just
is.
Just scream
going to
your question.
Yeah.
Okay, I have two things. Nandita, just a gentle correction that I want to bring up here. We are no longer using words like differently abled, specially abled, God special, Divyang, whatever it is that we are using.
Absolutely.
Okay, because being disabled and calling ourselves disabled is not a slur in any way. right? It is, we are no longer using words like harijan, because, you know, so there is no slur associated. But my actual question is associated with your being a director, okay? And Feroz, you said that many awards have been given to people who have played disabled characters.
Yeah.
Nandita, as a director...
Who have played the characters of... disabled characters.
Disabled
in movies,
characters. Yeah. Right? So, as a director, Nandita, what do you have to say about this? Why do we still have abled people playing disabled roles?
Yeah.
And there are so many disabled people.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why are we not having them in our films?
Yeah.
As a director, if you were to make a movie like this, what would your concerns be?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think. We do that for everything, unfortunately. You know, you've seen transgender characters being played by not transgender people. Sometimes it is also because there is, it's a very technical medium. It depends what the role is, because sometimes you may have to actually do things which are more difficult, in the sense that, you know, coming to a certain mark, you have to take a certain light, you have to, I don't know, complicated issues. But there are many characters I'm sure that we can take. People who are genuinely right for the role, instead of able people trying to be something else. So we have Shriram Raghavan here as well, who represents, I think, more mainstream cinema and knows more about it. I'm sure in his session, has he already done it? Shriram, have you already done it? Okay. Because I have always worked from the fringes of it and know less about it. I also watch very few films. So please don't make me speak for the whole industry. Nobody can, because I'm sure even he can't speak for the whole industry. But maybe can shed more light. But you're absolutely right. We as a society, and film industry is not out of that society, just need to be more sensitive, more aware, and more inclusive. There's no two ways about it, and I'll never defend that.
Let me end this session with a quote from Toni Morrison, the Nobel laureate, who also happened to be your co-juror in Cannes. Yes. A very beautiful quote where she wrote, "There is no time for despair, no place for self-pity, no need for silence, no room for fear. We speak, we write. This is how civilizations heal." Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Nandita Das.
No, I agree. Thank you so much for including me. Thank you.